Good morning. Good to be with you guys this morning. If you will bear with me, I want to do, Pastor Britt, grab your Bibles, go to John 11 as you're doing that. Just two more housekeeping things. Well, I don't want to call them housekeeping things. I just wanted to say before we dive into the message. One is this. If you didn't know, this past week we had what we call High Five. It is our summer kids camp. Yes. It was a little different this year, but I think it was even better. And I just wanted to pause and say, many of you served. We had 120 plus people who served at some point in High Five. Thank you. Like, seriously. Like, so faithful for so many of you who just, our children were so blessed and so loved, and families, the carnival on Friday night was incredible. Like, my family had a great time, and we don't have littles anymore. So, just thank you for loving our children so well and loving families so well, many of whom don't even go to Harvest. So, we're just grateful for you. And speaking of serving, I just wanted to also share one more thing, too. We're obviously at only a 9 a.m. service for the summer. This is just for the summer, by the way, if you hadn't heard that. September 10th, we will go back to a 9 and 11. So for those of you that love the 11 and are here this morning, you can get excited about that. But here's the thing. If you walked in here this morning, you may or may not have noticed, but hopefully you felt quite loved and cared for and safe. Right, we have a phenomenal parking team that helps people get to their spots. There are wonderful men and women who greet you at the doors coming into the building and the doors coming into the worship center. Men and women who help with communion and help people find their seats. We have an incredible team who not only run High Five, right, but are now caring for our children even this morning. The 9 a.m. is very hospitable. It's very loving. Our 11, we need some help. And so part of what we want to do this summer is get back to making sure that whether you come at 9 or you come at 11, you walk in here and you feel cared for and loved and welcome, and so do your children. And so I want to ask everybody, well, especially if you're not serving, to just begin praying about, you don't have to do anything today, just begin praying about where maybe could you help on Sunday so that everybody walking in feels welcome and cared for. But if you're not serving, there's an old phrase in the church. It's attend one, serve one. Right? I come to the 9 and attend, and maybe I serve at the 11 or vice versa. And you know what? If everybody does this, nobody does too much. If everybody does this, you're maybe serving once a month or twice a month. So most Sundays, you're still just coming to one service. But I want to ask you just to begin praying about it, and you're going to hear a whole lot more about that idea of attend one, serve one, kind of after the fourth holiday as we get rolling and closer to the fall. But we're looking forward to that. And as always, just as you do serve, thank you so much for it. This is one of the things that I know Amy and I have loved about our first 2 years here at Harvest, is how many of you do so faithfully serve and serve with love in your heart. So thank you for that. Let's pray before we jump into God's word. Father, grateful for this opportunity, grateful to open your word this morning and answer tough questions. And I'm grateful for our church family who are faithfully here, eager to worship, eager to love, eager to learn. And so would you bless our time as we open your word, let it go forth in the power that it contains, and may it change our heart, our soul, and our mind. May it bring healing where it's needed. May it bring courage where it's needed. May it bring understanding where it's needed. Whatever we might need this morning, would your word minister to us by your Spirit's power, we pray. Amen. So Pastor Tommy kicked off an incredible series, right? Tough questions or ask anything. What are some of the questions that you have asked? And today we're just going to jump right in. Our question this morning is this: why does God allow suffering and evil? And I'm going to add on to that, if he can stop it, right? How many of us have asked that question? We've been in the middle of suffering. God, why are you allowing this? I'm a Christian. God, I give my life to you. I'm following you. In fact, there are some preachers in our country and around the world today who would tell you, if you're suffering, it's because of your own sin. Because if you're faithful, the more faithful you are, the better your life should be. Well, that's a lie. Just ask Job. And so why does God allow suffering and evil if he can stop it? Maybe you've met somebody or made this statement yourself, right? I could never believe in a God who would allow fill in the blank. I remember sitting at a graduation party a few years ago, and I met this young gal, and we just got to talking, and she found that I was a pastor. And she said, let me ask you a question. She said, 2 years ago, my sister took her life. And a friend of mine said, well, if you commit suicide, you automatically go to hell. She goes, is that true? Because I could never believe in a God who would do that. Right? We've all probably heard that question. We've maybe even asked it ourselves when suffering comes, even as a child of God, right? The world wants to say, well, because of suffering and evil, your God must not be good. He must not be powerful enough because he can't stop it. So therefore, he either doesn't exist or he's none of the things you say he is, and I don't want to follow him. But that's not true. The truth is that God is loving, purely and perfectly loving. God is the only one who's actually good, and he's completely and entirely good. He is infinitely wise. He is all powerful. He can stop suffering. And oh, by the way, he will. We'll get to that. But why doesn't he now? That's our question for this morning. Can I just acknowledge one thing before we go into this too? Some of what we sometimes classify as suffering, it's our fault. I can't be the only one who's made enough mistakes in his life and have suffered from them. Anybody relate? I spent most of my junior high time and half of my high school time consecutively grounded for 3 years. I'm not embellishing. You can call my mom in Arizona. She'll tell you. And that grounding often had layers to it because I was already grounded and did something else and got grounded again and grounded. It just got bigger and badder and worse. And as a teenager, that was suffering. I can't do this. I can't do this. I can't do this. I can't do this. I've lost all rights and privileges. It's like I'm in prison. That was all my fault. I have no reason to go to God for that. And we've all made some mistakes that have maybe been a little bit worse than my grounding. But there aren't. But what we're talking about are the things that come unexpectedly, the things that we aren't the cause of, the things that just don't seem to make sense. And we find ourselves going, God, why? And my hope is that as we unpack John chapter 11 this morning, we can find some greater understanding to the answer to this question. So John chapter 11, if you're there, if you're not going to turn there, you're going to want to have a Bible this morning. The story of Lazarus, right? The brother of Mary and Martha, who you've already met in the Gospels if you're reading your way through. And now their brother has fallen ill. I'm going to give you, if you don't know the story, spoiler alert, he dies. Spoiler alert, he also rises from the dead. So because we're going to just jump right in, right? But there's two things I want you to know this morning when we talk about why does God do this. And the first is simply this. God cares about your suffering. Hear that. God cares about your suffering. Let's look at the text. We're going to start in the middle. We're going to kind of bounce around a little bit in the story, but we're going to start near the end of the story. Lazarus has already passed. They've sent word to Jesus. He's now on his way. He's now there. He's already talked to Martha, and now Mary comes in the scene. Now, when Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet, saying to him, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. If you had been here, right? This is that what if question we often ask the Lord. We're going to come back to this with Martha later, but what if, right? Lord, what if? Lord, if you would just do this. Lord, if you would just, what if? If you had been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come with her also, so again, we know that Mary and Martha are dear to his heart. He's obviously spent an amount of time with him. We know that the Jews who had come with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in his spirit and greatly troubled. These two words I want to stop on for a second, because every commentary I read says that actually deeply moved should be translated angry. Jesus saw their weeping, and he was angry. And greatly troubled really should be more of like an agitated or irritated, right? So it seems to be weird. Jesus saw their weeping, and he was angry and irritated. And some commentators would say that this is because he's angry at them because they just don't get it. I completely disagree. And I think most commentators actually disagree with those few that would say that. Think of what's going on here again. Jesus saw her weeping. Mary and Martha are dear to Jesus, as we're going to see, as is Lazarus, very dear to Jesus. This isn't some time when they're religious leaders who are getting on his nerves and irritating him. These are friends and people that he knows who are deeply moved, and so he's deeply moved himself. He's angry at the consequences of sin. He's angry that people he loves has to suffer. Have you ever been angry watching a loved one suffer? I know I get that way. I want to try to stop it. I want to do everything I can to stop it. This is what Jesus is doing in the moment. He cares. He cares so much, he's angry at their suffering. And he said to him, where have you laid him? They said to him, Lord, come and see. Jesus wept. By the way, if you've ever wanted to memorize scripture, shortest verse in all of scripture, Jesus wept. So the Jews said, see how he loved him. These people were very dear to Jesus' heart. He's angry at death and sin and its consequences. Jesus gets it, by the way. Maybe you've been in that position where something has happened and you find yourself blaming the Lord. You find yourself pointing fingers at the Lord. You find yourself yelling at him angrily, Lord, what's going on? Why is this happening? I didn't do it. I don't deserve it. And please hear me this morning to know that he gets it and he understands and he cares better than anybody else can. He's angry at the evil of death. He's agitated in this passage watching those he loves go through this. He's angry on our behalf when we suffer. And he gets it like no one else. Jesus knows suffering, by the way. He knows suffering better than anybody because he suffered worse than anybody. This is from the Old Testament. I'm kind of going to zip through it, but just notice, this is all that Jesus endured. See if you can relate to any of this. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. Can you relate yet? And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised. There it is again. We esteemed him not, right? We looked upon him and thought, yeah, there's nothing special about him. He's a loser, basically. Isaiah 53, describing Jesus as what the world would call a loser. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. You noticing something? His suffering is for us, by the way. Yet we esteemed him stricken and smitten by God. Well, not only is he a loser, he deserves this. This guy deserves his suffering. Really? Because it's for us. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his wounds, we are healed. All we like of sheep have gone astray. We've turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Yeah, we'll keep that. Jesus knows suffering, guys. If anybody gets it, God does. Whatever you've gone through, whatever you're maybe facing right now, he gets it like nobody else. It breaks my heart when I watch people run from God or blame God or just say, I want nothing to do with God. And yet he's the only one who actually truly understands. He's the only one who actually truly can help. He not only has suffered like no other, he actually did it for us. Because why? He loves you. He loves you that much. He suffered that much for you and me. And it's in him alone that we find understanding. It's we find our peace. We find our comfort, our strength, our hope, and our healing. Whatever we might face, that's where we're going to find it. What's the worst thing you've ever faced? I'm sure you've already thought of it this morning. The worst suffering you've ever had to endure. What is it? Maybe for some it's right now, and I hope that's not the case. I'm sorry if it is. But I've had a lot of time to think these past couple weeks in preparation for this, and a lot of things came into my head, but one stood out above all. When I was 5 years old, I was sexually abused by a family friend. And as a five-year-old, you don't get that. You don't understand it. It's more fearful. You're afraid. You get older, it turns to confusion because you still don't understand it. You get a little older, you get angry. You get older and you get big enough to do something about it, you get angry and you want revenge. That was the process in my head. Then I came to know Christ. And then I got really angry. Not at my abuser, but at the Lord. I got really angry. Why would you let this happen? Why would you let this happen? I was five. And in running to him instead of from him, I found everything. Do I fully understand why it happened? No, I don't. I don't get it. But I have healed. I've even moved to a place only by his grace of forgiveness for the person that did this to me. Not wanting revenge, but just forgiving, guys. It doesn't mark me. I don't walk around. I'm not a victim. I'm a child of the living God. That's how it works. We run to him, not from him. I love what the psalmist wrote. You think God doesn't care? I love this. Psalm 56, 8. You have kept count of my tossings. You've put my tears in your bottle. He's paying attention every second of every day. Last night, our power went off for 3 hours. It was hot. I could sleep. My family couldn't. They were tossing and turning all night long. God even knows that, let alone when you're tossing and turning because you're suffering and life is miserable and you're going through something. He's watching. He's paying attention. He gets it. There's no, it shouldn't be a surprise that go to Genesis 16 and read the story of Hagar, who's in the midst of some immense suffering. And what does she do? She says, "You're the God who sees. You're paying attention. You know what's going on. You actually care about me amidst my suffering." Yes, he does so much. Run to Jesus, not from him. In this story, if you read it all the way through in order, you'll notice that Martha does exactly that, as we'll see in a little bit. But Martha, Jesus gets on the scene and Martha runs to him. She's trying to get understanding. She's trying to get peace. She's trying to find joy. God cares about your suffering more than you could ever know. Don't run from him. Run to him. We're not promised understanding in this life. Sometimes we get it, but we're not promised it, and we may never get it, but we can go to the one who understands perfectly, and we can find everything, we will find everything we need to endure whatever we might face. Second thing I want you to know this morning is this, and this is where we're going to park and spend most of the rest of our time. God doesn't just care about your suffering. He's working in and through your suffering. God is working in and through your suffering. He's doing that in three ways that we're going to see. The first one is this. He's working in and through your suffering for his glory. Now, I know as soon as I say that, people are like, "Oh, great. Ooh, good. What good does that do me?" Right? I've had this said to me before. "Well, God's going to be glorified in it, John. Just hang in there." Great. What good does that do me? I learned something really cool this week that I never really fully grasped. Let's take a look. Go back to the beginning of the chapter, if you're still in John. So back to the beginning of the story, right? Now, a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. It was Mary who anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was ill. So the sister sent him, saying, "Lord, he whom you love," right? Again, here we know he's a friend of Jesus, "is ill." He's not dead. He's alive. But he's sick. But when Jesus heard it, he said, "This illness does not lead to death. It is for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it." Now, Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, "Let us go to Judea again." So let me ask you a question. If you called a family member, you were in trouble, you were in crisis mode, and you called, pick who it would be. Who would you call in the emergency? Mom, dad, brother, sister, aunt, uncle, grandma, grandpa? And they said, "Yeah, listen, I'll be there in 2 days." "Well, what are you doing?" "I'm just hanging out with my friends. I'll be there in 2 days." It seems incredibly insensitive. What is he thinking? What is he doing? But he gave us the reasoning, right? The glory of God, which again, even as we read the story, it's like, yeah, John, I get it. Fine. Glorifying God, it's a good thing. But how does that work? Well, think of God's glory in Scripture. We don't have the time to unpack this, but I was looking at a lot of verses on glory of God this weekend. Every time you read about the glory of God, something is happening. The glory of God filled the temple in the Old Testament. It was something they could tangibly see. They knew, wow, the glory of God filled the temple. God's right here with us. He's got it. He's with us. He's not going anywhere. When Moses went up on the mountain and God's glory covered the mountaintop, again, they could see it. God's glory is described as their rear guard in the Old Testament. When you read about the glory of God in Scripture, you read about God doing things actively. This seems incredibly insensitive, but how is God going to be glorified? Lazarus is going to raise from the dead. And by the way, Jesus will be with them the entire time. The point is this. When you read about the glory of God, what we're talking about is the presence of God. It's something you can see. When God does miracles, we get the privilege of seeing that and hearing about it. When somebody comes to know Christ, that's God's glory, God working. When we are transformed into the image of God, that's God being glorified. We can see that. We can watch it happen. When relationships are restored, when a brother or sister steps in and serves. You know what? This past week in High Five, God was immensely glorified. Why? Because men and women used their gifts to minister to others and people were loved well. God was glorified. And all of this tells us is that when that is going on, this is the point. It means God's right there in the middle of it. As we've already talked about, God is right there in the middle of it. This is how God's glory helps us, by the way. Instead of just saying, well, hey, come on, buck up, guys. Buck up, God's working through your trials. He's going to be glorified. No, which simply means he's there. He's right there beside you. He's right there with you, and he's actively doing something. That gives me comfort. Saying God's glorified doesn't necessarily give me comfort, but that gives me comfort and strength and courage to go on. He is on display. His power is present, his attributes, his perfection, his person. My family and I have been watching the College Baseball World Series this week. A good friend of our son is on LSU, and hopefully they're going to win it all today. But I've been thinking this team is playing, all the teams are playing incredible, but I was imagining, what if one of the coaches of these teams, we'll use LSU, but what if the coach of LSU, he was the coach, and he wasn't there for the entire tournament? He just wasn't there. In fact, none of the coaches were, the players were. And the players rallied together, and they put a lineup together, and the players made the decisions, and the players went on a field, and they played, and they got the hits at the right time, and they got the strikeouts at the right time, and hit the home runs at the right time. And all said and done, on the last game, they come out and they win. LSU wins. No coaches around. And they're on the field, and they're celebrating, and they're glorifying. And the coaches come walking out on the field. They're like, yes, yes, we did it. We did it. Anybody giving that coach any credit at all? I'm thinking players, parents, everybody's kind of like, you guys can leave now? You did nothing. You weren't even here. We did this without you. When we talk about God's glory, what we're saying is God is right here the whole time, working in your suffering, working through your suffering. He is present. He hasn't gone anywhere. He is right there the entire time. So when we say that God is working in and through your suffering for his glory, it means that God is in it with you. He hasn't left you, and he's right there working in your life. God works in and through our suffering for his glory. Secondly, he works in and through our suffering for our good. So in the story, Jesus basically says, we read this, right? So let's go. They have this little back and forth conversation. We're going to skip a few verses simply because it's a back and forth conversation between Jesus and the disciples of like, hey, we shouldn't go there. It was dangerous. People want you. We're going. So we're going to pick up the story down here in verse 14. Then Jesus told them plainly, Lazarus has died, and for your sake, I'm glad that I was not there so that you may believe. Let's remember this phrase. Right? What do we say? God is working not just for his glory, but he's also working for our good, so that you may believe. He's talking to the disciples. They're not non-believers. What he's saying to them is, your faith is going to be strengthened. You're going to learn a whole lot more about me. This is for your good, basically, as to why we didn't go yet, because I'm going to do good in your life as a result of it all. But let us go to him. So I love this. We always pick on Thomas, don't we? Oh, the guy always doubted. I got to see the holes. But here's a moment here. Look at this. So Thomas, right, called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, let us also go that we may die with him. I love that. Because we do. We make fun of him so much. But he's like, hey, listen, I don't even understand. But if we're going to die, let's go. Let's go in glory, right? Let's die if we need to. Doesn't fully get why they're going, but. Now, when Jesus came, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. So he's been dead for a few. Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles off, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them in concerning their brother. So when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she what? She went and she met him, right? We run to Jesus. We don't run from him and blame him. We run to him. I love that. But Mary remained seated in the house. I want to acknowledge something. If you remember the first story of Mary and Martha, Mary was the one at the feet of Jesus, and Martha was the one working and hustling. And it's kind of a flip-flop. Martha is the one who runs to Jesus, and Mary just sits. We're not told why. We aren't told anywhere why the flip-flop or why they acted this way. I tend to think this is simply a picture that we all grieve differently. We all deal with suffering differently. Some of us, day one, we're going to run to Jesus. I want to get this. I want understanding. I want to deal with it. I want to deal with it right now. That's me. Some of us, I just need time. I need time to process. I'm not running from Jesus, but I need to sit quietly and I need to process. That's a lot of us as well. We're all going to do it differently. I think that's all that is, just so you know. But Martha's there. It said, Martha said to Jesus, do you remember this? Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Again, the what if, Lord, right? How often do we put that phrase forward, the what if? If you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that whatever you ask from God, God will give you, right? It sounds like she's like, hey, listen, he died. You could have stopped it, but I know what you can do. I've heard the stories. She doesn't come out and say it, but clearly she's asking Jesus to raise her brother from the dead. Whatever you ask from God, God will give you. And Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. I love this. Martha said to him, well, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. Jesus just told her what he was going to do, but somehow she missed it. Now, again, I don't want to make fun of her because I know how much I miss on a given day, right? But she missed it. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live, and everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. And then I love this question. Do you believe this? So Martha didn't quite get that her brother's about to rise. Jesus doesn't pick on her. He doesn't make fun of her. He doesn't get mad at her. He's like, oh, I'm just going to keep talking to her. Do you get this? Do you believe, basically saying, do you believe in me? Do you believe in who I am at the core of who I am? No matter what happens, even if, forget the what if or the even if and all that stuff, do you believe in this? And I love it. She said to him, yes, Lord. I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God who is coming into the world. In this moment, her brother's still in the grave. In this moment, she doesn't know that he's going to rise from the dead. The what if question she had, Lord, what if? Lord, if you had been here, you could have done something. Lord, I know who you are. You can do something, right? All her hope is in this, that Jesus just might do something. Maybe bring her brother back and change the tide and give her exactly what she wanted. And she moved from what I would call the what if to the even if. Jesus, even if my brother stays in the grave, you are the Son of God. You are the resurrection and the life. And that's really, truly all that matters. How often do we get stuck in the what if? And I don't say that with judgment. I don't. I've done my share of yelling at God. Like, and I'm not exaggerating that. I've gone out into the woods at times, and when I've struggled, when I've been in seasons of suffering, when I didn't know what the Lord was doing, and literally screamed at the top of my lungs at him. I later confessed, and I knew I was wrong. I'm always wrong, right? The beauty is he can handle it. He can handle the what ifs. So please don't feel judgment when I say we need to move from the what if to the even if, right? We get there, right? And he can handle our what ifs, but as long as we're willing and ready to keep coming to him and move to the even if. Even if this doesn't turn out the way I hope and the way I pray and the way that I'm even begging you, even if my loved one isn't healed or whatever it might be, Lord, you are still God and you are still on the throne. You are the resurrection and the life. What I love about Martha's example is that her eyes are on Jesus the entire time. She trusts in who he is. She trusts in his timing. I know that my brother will rise on the last day. So I know I will see him again, whether he comes back right now or not. He will rise again on the last day. And you are the Christ, and that's all that matters. Eyes on Christ. We have such beautiful examples of this throughout Scripture. 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 12, King Jehoshaphat of Judah. They are literally about to be overrun by a massive horde of, let's just say, bad people. And I love this line. He says, we do not know what to do. He's talking to the Lord. But our eyes are on you. See this same theme of just leaning into the Lord, trusting the Lord, staying with our eyes on Jesus, running to him. He is working for our good. It's not always going to necessarily make sense in the moment, but we have to trust him and keep our eyes on him. I love that the Lord asked this question, do you believe this, right? And Martha moved from the what if to the even if. See, the good in her life, God is working in and through our suffering for good. The good in Martha's life, and usually in our life, is not necessarily that the prayer gets answered. The good is that we grow in our walk with the Lord. We become more sanctified. We learn to trust in him. We come to believe in him. That's the good that's being brought about. You know, often when we go to comfort somebody in the midst of suffering, what do we quote? What do we quote, right? Romans 8:28. God is going to use this for good. God is going to use your suffering for your good. And you're like, oh, yay, yay, yay. It's a great verse, please. Sorry, that totally came out insensitive. It's God's word. It's great. But read the next verse. Verse 29 talks about what is the good that he's going to bring about, our sanctification. God is working all things together for good in the life of those who love him for your sanctification. That's the good. Some preachers will try to promise you that good is going to be health and wealth. No, it's not. That everything you ever wanted, you're going to get. The good is our sanctification, our becoming more like Christ, our trusting more in Christ, a greater faith. It may not be what we want, but it's what we need. See, this good and perfect and holy and righteous God is always working for what is good and right in our lives. I recently was told a story of a professor that I had at Trinity. I had him years ago, and I didn't know this story then, but I've heard it since. And he lost his daughter to cancer at one stage, right? We talk about the suffering. These are the things, the unexpected. The Lord, why would you do this? Why would you do this? And in an interview, somebody asked the professor this. He said, so, right, God allows suffering and evil and all this stuff. Would you want to go through that again, right? If we're saying that God providentially is over all of this and he's using it for good and he's using it for glory, would you want to go through it again? And he said, no, I wouldn't want to go through that again. But I wouldn't want to be who I was before it happened. Think on that for a second. I wouldn't want to go through it again, but I wouldn't want to be who I was before it happened. That made me think back to this week. Again, obviously, I wouldn't want to go through what happened to me when I was five again. By no means would I want that for anybody. But I see eventually when I came to the Lord and I yelled at him and I had it out with him and came around to his way and let him heal me and transform me, I wouldn't want to be what I was before I knew all of that either. It is for our good. We can't always grasp it in the moment, but you get to the other side and it truly is beautiful what the Lord works in our lives. It's for his glory, it's for our good, and the last and third one is this, it's for the salvation of others. God works through suffering, both other people's and our own, for the salvation of other folks. Let's move on to verse 38. Then Jesus, deeply moved again, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and the stone lay against it. Jesus said, take away the stone. Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, Lord, by this time there will be an odor, right? He stinks, Jesus. We're not going to, it's going to be bad. People are going to pass out. For he has been dead for 4 days. Jesus said to her, did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see what? The glory of God. All the way back to the beginning of the story, right? He's going to be glorified because he's there and he's doing something and he's about to do something even greater. So they took away the stone and Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me. But I said this on account of the people standing around that they may believe that you sent me. See, it's not just the 12. It's not just Mary and Martha. If you remember early in the story, it said that a lot of people came with. They heard there was something going on at the tomb. They wanted to see what was going on. So a lot of Jews came who didn't yet follow Christ. And he says, I'm doing this so that they may believe. And he goes on. When he said these things, he cried out with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The man who had died came out, his hands and feet bound with linen strips and his face wrapped with a cloth. Jesus said to them, unbind him and let him go. I just want to stop there for a second. This is a question I have for Lazarus. I don't know if anybody else has this, but like, are you looking at Jesus at this moment and saying, dude, like, I was in glory. What do you call me back for? I don't know. Maybe it's just me. I have a weird sense of humor, but I was like, I was there. You're bringing me back. I love my family and all, but sorry. You guys can put in a request to have Pastor Britt back. It's okay. I'm fine with that. But here it is again. This is this, right? Verse 45. Many of the Jews, therefore, right, who had come with Mary and had seen what he did, believed in him. God uses suffering and evil. He works through suffering and evil for the salvation of others. Guys, this to me is the biggest piece in the answer to the question. Why does God allow suffering and evil? Because there are many on this planet who don't yet know him. To me, that's the biggest one. I think it's bonus that we get to see his glory. I think it's bonus that he brings about good in my life because of it. That's to me the main reason why he allows it. Because think about this with me for a second. God can get rid of evil and suffering today. He could have done it at any point in history. But do you know what that means? If he decides that tomorrow, Monday morning, suffering and evil are gone, you know what that means? All the people that you love that don't know Jesus are gone. That's what it means. Not that they're evil, but they aren't children of God. All of it goes. What's going to be heaven eventually, right? There will be no unbelievers in heaven. There'll be no sin in heaven. So all those that are still living in sin are gone. That really hit me hard this week, literally. It hit me so hard when I really started to begin to think on that. That's really why. To do away with suffering and evil right now means family members of mine are gone, never with a chance to come to know Christ. Matthew 24 says this, right? And the gospel of the kingdom will be proclaimed throughout the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come. God has a plan. Evil and suffering, by the way, they've been defeated. They've already lost. It's coming to an end, just not in our timing, just not the way we want, but it is coming to an end. If you have time this afternoon, go home and read the beginning of Romans chapter 9, and what you're going to find is the Apostle Paul saying, hey, Lord, listen, the Jewish people matter so much to me that if it means I need to suffer and die so that they get saved, then okay. My heart's not there. I want it to be. Maybe for some of my family it is, but for people I don't know, that's wrong of me. But Paul was willing to die if that's what it meant for people to get saved. It's that important. It's that big of a deal. God is working through our suffering to bring others to Christ. By the way, how we suffer around us is a witness, too. We need to remember that. The way that we suffer, why? Because we have hope. 1 Thessalonians tells us, right? We don't grieve as those. We don't suffer as those who have no hope because we do in Christ. We know the promises of Christ. We know the character of Christ. Author Randy Alcorn once wrote this. He says, the cross is God's answer to the question, why don't you do something about evil? God did do something. And what he did was so powerful that it ripped in half from top down the fabric of the universe itself. God does not merely empathize with our sufferings. He inserted himself into history through Jesus. What Jesus suffered, God suffered. God ordained and allowed Jesus' temporary suffering so he could prevent our eternal suffering. Good Friday isn't called Bad Friday because we see it in retrospect. We know that out of the appallingly bad came inexpressible good. And that good trumps the bad. Although the bad was temporary, the good is eternal. God is working in and through our suffering. He cares about it, and he's working through it. He is the resurrection and the life, and he's doing everything he can for his glory, our good, and the salvation of others. But the question I was asked, I was talking to some folks about this week, trying to get some feedback. The question I kept getting asked is this, John, but what do I do when my loved one isn't raised from the dead? Because it's easy to read this story. Now, granted, I think we had a great example of Martha, especially. Her faith was strengthened even though her brother hadn't yet come back. But it's still hard. And so whatever that suffering is that might come down the road for you, right? What if my loved one still does pass of cancer? What if my mom or dad does get Alzheimer's and we have to deal with that for years? What if? What if my marriage doesn't get better, John? What if my rebellious child doesn't come back, John? What if? How do we move? Really, the question is, how can we better move to the even if? Even if they don't, Lord, you're still God and I'm still right here following you. We can definitely hold to these things we've learned today, but I want to share just three quick things in closing that I think will help. And one is this. It's the idea of perspective. Paul said it really, really well in Corinthians. He said, we don't know fully. Someday we will fully know, but we don't now know fully. You ever been in counseling? You ever sat in counseling with somebody? Maybe, and have you ever sat in counseling with somebody else? Like, it's for the two of you. You need it. And suddenly, Amy and I have done a few times, and Amy shares, and I'm like, huh. I never saw it from that perspective. I never knew that what I did hurt you in that way or made you feel that way. I needed to hear it from her to understand her perspective so that I could seek the forgiveness I need. Right? Perspective is really, really important. Look at this with me. Something fun, a little puzzle. How many blocks are there? How many do you see? I'm going to save us a little bit of time. Right? We've got 1, 2, 3. Sorry, I'm standing in your way. 4, 5, 6, 7. Right? Right? 7. Right? 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I like puzzles. I tried to draw it. It didn't work. But just, I wanted to use this for, so if this is us, I don't have the greatest handwriting, and this is God. In reality, we see seven things. I'm gonna write up here. Why God sees a million or more. He sees an infinite amount. What we see is nothing compared to what God is doing and orchestrating in us and through us and around us. Perspective matters. We need to remember this amidst our suffering. This is a great tool to help. All we tend to see is the here and the now and this tiny little moment, and God is looking at the tapestry of eternity and all that he's trying to accomplish. He's looking at your life from beginning to end in this earth and what he's trying to accomplish. Perspective matters. Let us never forget Isaiah 55, 8 through 9. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways and my thoughts than your thoughts. Somebody else shared this idea with me. I was thinking of, like, I think back to this. I'm like, think of a conversation between my son and I, right? He's 23, I'm 53. He's not always going to fully get it, but, you know, we're both men. He's going to get the majority of what I'm probably saying to him. Some he may not just get because of life's experiences, right? He can understand me most of the time. But this relationship isn't like father-son, even though, yes, we are children of God. This relationship is much more like me and my dog. We have a 90-pound black lab named Jeter. And Jeter gets a few things that I tell him. But in the grand scope of the things I tell Jeter to do, he might get about this much while I'm telling him this much because he's a dog. He's a completely different nature than I am, a completely different, right? So that's kind of like, I'm kind of indirectly calling us all dogs. Forgive me. But we are, right? We forget the perspective. We get so little right now. We will someday. Someday we will know fully, but we don't yet. And so we need to keep that in mind. That helps us move from the what if to the even if. Second thing that helps us move from the what if to the even if is this. It's the promises of God. Right? And guys, we could spend weeks and years on this. But here's one. Talk about suffering. Not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who's been given to us. It's a promise. You can hold to this. You can hold God to this. You can look at him and say, God, you promised this. Where's the endurance? Where's the character? Your spirit's there. I want to know your love and your hope, and it will happen. We can hold to these promises, and there are hundreds of them in Scripture. God says, I am with you always in Matthew 28. In Hebrews 13, I will never leave you nor forsake you. And his whole rejoicing piece, by the way, I know we kind of skip over that. Yeah, I don't rejoice in my sufferings. And yet Peter and Paul and James all wrote about how they rejoiced in their sufferings. I think it's because they get all of this. They got all of this really, really well. I think it took them time to get there. I think it's a sign of maturity in the Lord that we grow and we hold to the promises more and we get more of his perspective and we recognize that he's working the good in my life and his glory and the salvation of others. We can get there. But here's one last promise, and then I'll get to the last piece. 1 Peter 5, 10. I don't have this one on the board, but if you want to write it down, listen to this. A promise of the living God to us, his children. And after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. That's a promise from our God. That's something he will do in our lives. And the last one is simply this, not just perspective and promises of God, but the person of God. Never forget who he is. Creator of the heavens and earth, God over all things. If you've never read the story of Job, do it. If this is something you struggle with, do it. I'll shorten it for you, right? Job had everything. Job was considered a man after God's own heart in his own way. He loved God and God loved him, and Satan got permission from God to test Job. Job lost everything. If you think your suffering is bad, go read about Job's. He lost everything. Many children, all dead. Many workers, all dead. Animals, crops, lost it all. Only thing he had left was his wife and himself. But he didn't even have his own health. He was covered in all kinds of boils and blisters and disgusting. Nobody wanted anything to do with it. He lived in sackcloth and ashes and basically just sat there. His own wife, would you just curse God and die? I want nothing to do with God or you. miserable as it could possibly be. And much like I shared earlier how he yelled at God, I don't know if Job yelled, but Job kind of was like, Lord, what's going on? Kind of goes after him for chapter after chapter after chapter. Job's friends kind of come in. His friends start off strong. What do? They just sit with him. So often the right thing to do when our friends are suffering, we don't need to offer a word, just sit with them and love them. And then his friends turn into, well, this must be your fault. You must have done something wrong, but you didn't. And God finally responds to Job. And God's done responding, and Job is still in his ashes and sackcloth, still covered with boils. And this is just a part of what he says. I know that you can do all things, that no purpose of yours can be thwarted. Who is this that hides counsel without knowledge? Therefore, I have uttered what I did not understand, things too wonderful for me, which I did not know. In that moment, Job realized, man, I know this, Lord, and you know everything. I know nothing compared to you, God. But I know this, you are God. You can do all things. No purpose of yours can be thwarted. Same as Martha. God, even if I don't get my life back, even if I sit here in boils and ashes, even if my wife hates my guts and hates you, even if my children were to never come back, Lord, I am in it with you because you are God, and I don't fully get it, but you are God, and that's all that matters. Job never gets his questions fully answered either, by the way. Never gets his questions fully answered. He does get his life restored. The even if is the right place to be, and sometimes we do get that bonus like Job. But we need to remember that God is faithful. So let me just ask this question as I begin to wrap things up. How has he taken care of you in the past? You're here today. My guess is at some point in your life, unless you're a newborn, you've endured suffering. How did he take care of you? Do you write these things down? Do you remember so that next time you come, you remember all the ways he's been faithful? So that next time it gets easier, it's easier to keep in this mindset. It's easy to remember he's working for my good right now. He's working for the salvation of others. He's working for his glory, which means he's right here with me and he cares deeply. We need to remember these things. We have a God. Well, I shouldn't just say we have a God. God is completely good. He's infinitely wise and all-powerful. He cares about our suffering. He understands our suffering better than anyone. And he's working in and through our suffering, not only for his glory, but for our good and the salvation of others. We need to hold to his promises, we need to trust in his character, and we need to see things from his perspective. Let me just end with this. One more promise as we talk about suffering. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. He won't have to count them anymore because they'll be gone. Death shall be no more. Neither shall be their mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. This is truth. It's not wishful thinking. It's not hopeful thinking. Death, evil, suffering have already lost because Christ died on the cross. And all of this is coming to an end. And so until that moment when we stand in his presence, we can be confident that he cares and he knows and he's with us and he is bringing about our good, the salvation of others, and his glory in the interim. Amen? Amen? Would you stand and pray with me? Father, we thank you so much that we get to gather on a weekly basis. We get to gather and worship you and celebrate you. We get to enjoy your presence with us as we sing and as we learn, as we take communion, as we simply see each other. You are here in this place moving. We thank you for it. Your glory is present. You are here and you are active, and we thank you so much for it. God, I personally thank you for this message. I needed to be reminded of some of these things. I needed to learn some of these things anew, to have my own faith strengthened, to be reminded of how much good you are working in my life and all of our lives through our suffering. God, I pray specifically for brothers and sisters right now who are maybe in that season. And I pray you would manifest your presence to them. They would see your glory. They would see you actively working in them and through them. They would know your presence. They would know your comfort and your strength and your peace and your hope like never before. I pray that your truth would be on their minds daily, remembering, God, that you are working, that you are with them. I pray that they would begin to see things from your perspective. Remind them of your character and your promises. Remind all of us of this, Lord, so that whenever suffering might come, we can, like so many have gone before, stand firm. We can, like Martha or like Job, stand firm and not be shaken. God, would you move in us in such a way that suffering would never cause us to shake or to question or to doubt, but we would be so firm in our faith in you, Lord. We could face it and be a great witness to the world around us. Minister to us when these seasons come, we pray, and help us to trust in you and run to you and to no one else, I pray. And thank you for your goodness and faithfulness in all things. Amen.